the situation that we're in requires extraordinary measures. So that's what we're doing here, extraordinary measures. We continue to just pump, you know, pump up the volume here. Let us just go over some basics real quickly. There's four stages that we go through as we are liberated from the false belief in mortal mind. One is we desire eternal life. The second stage is that the beginning stage is we desire something better than mortal life. We say, no, I want eternal life. Second phase is we pray for eternal life. We pray for it. Say, give it, please, divinity, please give it to me, give it to me, give it to me. Third stage is we assert that I have it. I am eternal life. I have eternal life. This, you know, I am it. This is it. I am. And the fourth stage is we imitate abstraction, pure abstraction, which is beyond concepts. See, anyway, those are the four stages. And so we're just streamlining the awareness of this. There's four stages. First, desiring. Second, praying. Third, asserting. Fourth, imitating abstraction. Because what eternal life cannot be defined. So we're so used to definitions and defining, even positive ways. The most positive ways of defining are just as inaccurate and meaningless as the most negative ways of defining it, ultimately. Ultimately. But because of our continuity fear, we go through these four stages. We don't want to get fixated at any of the stages. We want to continue with faith in that there is this way of getting free of the delusion of mortal mind. The central delusion that trips us up, well, ultimately it's the continuity fear, is that we're afraid, we're so used to pretending that we are mortal mind. We're really eternal spirit. We're pretending we're mortal mind, that we're born in a body to die, you know, in a world of a universe of impermanence. This is a pretense. It's our own pretending. And we're so used to pretending that if we realize, oh, this is all a pretense, mortal mind is nothing but a pretense, so I'm just going to give up pretending, that's all. Then we say, okay, that's great. And then we say, wait a minute. I thought pretending is my functioning. We think it's our functioning. We think without that, you know, how are we going to function? And so we're very much reluctant and afraid to give up this pretense. So what we do is we deceive ourselves about this. And we say, well, part of mortal mind is bad. That's the part we don't like. But part of mortal mind is good. And we just need the good part of mortal mind to be in charge of the bad part. And, okay, and that will solve our problems. So we get to continue pretending that we're mortal mind this way. And you see this being played out sociologically in the world. It's like we say, well, the part of mortal mind is bad, you know, and good. We go back and forth on it. Well, you know, one day it's the pants that are good and the skirts that are bad. The other day it's the skirts that are good and the pants that are bad, that kind of thing. And then you throw in a pantsuit in the middle of that and say, well, we can kind of find a middle ground and, you know, like that. Same old nonsense. Now, This is the basics that obviously you don't stop pretending that you're mortal mind. We do not stop pretending that we're mortal mind by saying that mortal mind is real and that there's a good part to it and a bad part to it. And the answer is just to find the good part to it, and then we can be, you know, happy mortal mind. And yet this is what we try to do out of our continuity fear. You say, we don't dare stop pretending. Spirit, stop pretending. Spirit says, if I stop pretending, I won't exist. I mean, I won't have any functionality. Because spirit has identified with this dynamic of pretending. It's not so much that we're identified with objects. I know you hear this. You hear a lot of spiritual teachings say, well, you're identifying with objects and stuff. That's not really what it is. We're identified with pretending. that we are mortal, that we are dead. From the standpoint of reality, what dies was never alive in the first place, because all creation, all life is eternal life. So anything that dies is just a pretense, a pretending, and it was never alive in the first place. It's just nothing. So mortal mind doesn't exist at all. It's only spirit pretending that it's dead, and then insisting that it's not pretending, that there's some actual causation independent of spirit causing this mortal existence we call mortal mind. But mortal mind is just this non-existent imaginary causative principle that disguises the fact that it's actually spirit pretending all this mortality and impermanence. It's just a dream, a pretense of spirit. So the important emphasis is to see this, recognize it, say, okay, there's four stages. Continuity fear about over this pretending is the only problem we have. It's the only one we have. If we were not afraid to drop pretending, we would drop it like instantly. All of us, we would drop it instantly. But we're afraid, thinking that somehow our functionality is, instead of what God created it as, is now pretending to not be functional. Really, mortal mind is like spirit pretending that spirit is not functional. So we're afraid if we give up this pretense that we're not functional, we won't have any function at all. This is the trap that we're in. And we have to go careful with this trap, because it's a great, great fear, and it's an unacknowledged fear. The more we acknowledge it, the easier it gets for us. Instead, we run off on all these wild goose chases that seem very spiritual, that seem full of promise, and ultimately end up just wasting our time. Yeah, I'm going to find the good mortal mind, the good part of it, you know, and the role switch, you know, first the idol switch. Here's the good idol of mortal mind, and they're out to crush the bad idol of mortal mind. And so you have all these social engineering, these movements. First, you know, men are the management position, it's their style, and then it flips, and there's women's style, and they're the ones who are doing it. Right now we're in a style of a female women's management style in the world called radical feminism, radical corporate feminism. And it's a style of management. It's controlling the narrative. Say, follow this narrative, and we will find happy mortal mind in a wonderful millennial happy mortal kingdom. You know, and this mortal kingdom will last forever. And there's another aspect we need to look at, is that the ancients and us still now, they prayed for immortality. Immortality. What are they really meaning? What they're meaning is they want mortal life to continue forever. You know, they want the belief in mortal mind. They just don't want the suffering of mortal mind. So they say, I don't want to die. I want to stay mortal forever. And they call it immortality. It really means I have this mortal existence forever. It doesn't disappear. But what is this really? This is praying that we can keep pretending forever. So this shows how severe the continuity fear is. If we're afraid, if we're not pretending to be mortal mind, we won't have any functionality at all, and therefore we will have no causative principle at all, and therefore no existence, no effects, no existence, no experience. If there's no causative principle, no effects of this, there's no experience. So we're afraid of just this black hole of annihilation if we stop pretending. So we've been praying throughout history on this planet and around the cosmos of, I just want mortal mind to last forever. This is what our prayers have been. And we've spun our religions around this prayer, that we want mortal mind to last forever. Because deep within us, we're afraid that, you know, mortal mind, the belief in mortal mind is itself mortal. And this is what terrifies us. So we said, well, first we got to solidify mortal mind and put it on the right foundation, make sure that it's permanent. And then we'll talk about, then we'll talk turkey, then we'll, you know, listen to the Holy Spirit or something. It doesn't work that way. This is what doesn't work. Because mortal mind has no reality. It doesn't exist. It has no causative principle whatsoever. It's a figment of spiritual imagination. It's a false causative that spirit has imagined to hide the true causative principle Okay. Which is spirit pretending. It's not mortal mind, and is not, there's no mortal mind at all. What is pretending all this impermanence and mortality is spirit, not mortal mind. So these are just the basics, you know, we go over the basics, but going over the basics is the most powerful, super powerful practice, the most powerful, it's the most pragmatic. We have to see the landscape. And then once we see the landscape, then we can do a specific practice, which is imitating abstraction, which is the final step, the fourth phase, that opens up the door to the experiencing of what you might say, well, it's not really a stage, the fifth estate, you can't even call it, what can you call it? Abiding in the self, some say abiding in the self, abiding in our true nature, vision of oneness, it goes on and on, but it's not really important to try and label it at all. What's important, though, is the abidance. So the fourth stage is going for abidance, whereas the third stage is going for glimpses of truth, which it does provide. The fourth phase is going for to abide in the truth that we have glimpsed. So first we desire truth. Second, we pray for truth. Third, desire truth, we often fixate upon some savior. Or, how do we put it? We long for a savior. We desire a savior. In the second phase, we believe there is a savior and we fixate upon the savior and pray to the savior. In the third phase, we actually begin to glimpse the truth for ourselves. We glimpse the truth for ourselves, and we say, "Hey, you know, I can. It's not just the Savior that you know is saved. I can be saved too, actually. And not as a slave of the Savior, but actually, just truly, freely liberated myself. And then the fourth phase is then to abide in this liberation, true liberation from the delusional belief in mortal mind." To abide in, the eternal mind, eternal self, eternal spirit. Abide in the experiencing of this. And to that end, this practice of imitating abstraction is supremely effective. Whereas in the third phase, we're asserting, we're glimpsing, and we get a glimpse that we say, "Oh, I want to grab a hold of that." We're so excited. "Ah, I got a glimpse. Let me grab this." And then it seems to disappear in us, and we say, "What happened? What happened?" It's because of our continuity fear, unrecognized. We still don't clearly recognize our continuity fear, but in the third phase, getting frustrated by getting these glimpses, we start to realize, hey, I have a severe problem, continuity problem. And we become conscious, more and more conscious of this. And when we finally, become very, very aware of this, then we're willing to practice the fourth phase. We say, "Wow, I really have to account for this continuity problem. Otherwise, I'm just going to be stuck in the third phase forever." Occasionally getting glimpses. Every 10 years we get a glimpse or something, and this is our life. And we say, "Wow, this is not fulfilling at all." Whereas in the second phase, they push it all into after you die. They say, "Yeah, well, mortal mind exists, and we just have to suffer from mortal mind. But after the body dies, then we'll be able to, get glimpses of heaven. We'll go to purgatory, we'll get maybe glimpses of heaven, and then after that's over, then we'll be able to abide." It's all pushed into the future. Okay, that's the second phase. It's all pushed into the future. The third phase says, "No, I want it right now. But the most I can get are these glimpses." And then the fourth phase is you say, "No, I can abide in it right now." No, there really are, if you look historically, there really are these phases. There's these four basic phases. And of course, from the standpoint of wisdom, you know precision. You're very precise, including you know precisely how much precision to use. This is very important to say this, is one of the traps we get caught up in is this uncertainty about how much detail, how much precision do we need. And what I would say is from the standpoint of true wisdom, you know exactly how much precision to use. So you're precise about how much precision. So you're not just willy-nilly stuck in this ego idea, well, I have to detail everything, I have to detail, I have to detail, detail. No, that's blind. You know, first of all, let's be precise about how much precision we need. And we don't need that much precision. We're painting a big picture here, big picture here. So the ego always tries to demand more precision, specifics, demand, I want specifics, specifics, specifics. And wisdom says, yeah, I'm specifically clear about how much specifics I need to give you. That is being specific. This is how much specifics you need. That is specific. And the ego says, no. And it's like robotically, no, I need more specifics, more specifics, more. It's delaying tactic. This is a delaying tactic of the ego. Demanding specifics. Well, what exactly? And it's no never ending. The ego never stops its demands for more and more specifics. Delaying tactic. Out of continuity fear, which is based on our fear, it will stop pretending and we won't have any functioning at all. But it's kind of funny because pretending isn't causative at all, really. Pretending to be mortal mind, there's no causativeness in mortal mind at all. And pretending is not really causative. It's not really bringing about any new identity at all. So it's not causative. So we're afraid that by giving up non-causativeness, we won't have any causativeness, which is completely absurd. And yet, we're very concerned about this. And it cannot be resolved intellectually. This is where fixation can creep in, even in the fourth phase, is it cannot be resolved intellectually at all. This is at the level of delay. Intellectualism, even in the fourth phase, is in the service of delay. That's exactly what it's in the service of. And it's still pushing it into the future. Pushing it somewhere. You know, instead of experiencing it, it's pushing it into specifics and conceptualizations, etc., instead of actually practicing. So, one has to actually practice, as I did this morning, of all sorts of imitations of abstraction, which is very humbling, because you're not using your intellect at all when you're practicing. You're using wisdom, but not your intellect. The intellect is really what keeps demanding specifics and explanations. Explanations are really for work. Give me more specifics. I want more details. I want more explanations, more details, more specifics. Whereas if in practicing, you're merely practicing. You're getting out of your own way. You're just saying, yeah, I'm absolutely sure that help has arrived, and I'm absolutely sure that help has not arrived. I'm absolutely clear about my path, and I'm absolutely not clear about my path. But in practicing, what we want to do is we want to emphasize the positive, because the whole point of this is to abide in this, you know, glorious, blissful peace that we are. So it's 100% positive. And We have to manage the elation of this properly. Otherwise, we will go back to, you know, believing in mortal mind and trying to put it in the context of mortal mind, and then thinking, oh, I found the good area of mortal mind. I found the good part of mortal mind. Great. I just got to avoid the bad part now. And keep in mind that, again, concepts about truth, they're all equally not true. There's you know, say, wow, I'm eternal life. The concept of eternal life is really no more useful to us than the concept of mortal mind. Ultimately. It has a pragmatic usage to evaporate the continuity fear up to a point. But setting down the continuity fear complex itself, at that point, concepts don't have any usefulness anymore. Except to cancel themselves out, or to balance themselves out, as it were. So that you're neither neither fixating on the good concepts nor fixating on the bad concepts. I'm neither fixating that eternal life is wonderful, nor am I fixating that eternal life doesn't even exist or is terrible. So you have to keep yourself from, you know, fixating conceptually on in any way in order to abide in truth, in our true nature, in order to abide in that. We cannot fixate on any concepts, either good or bad. So this is why it's very important in the fourth phase to practice the ways that I've explained in you know, many videos now, in the recent ones, that specifically focus on this, and we will continue to do this, but understanding that there are these four phases, and I call them phases because when we're in these phases, we really feel that the next phase might somehow be interfering with the phase that we're involved in. You know, we kind of like are like afraid of it, because of course it gets us closer to dropping pretense altogether, and this is what we're quite afraid of. So each phase says, I need this level of pretending. I need to believe, you know, that I'm not, that I can keep pretending to this extent, and so I don't want to go farther than that. And so the phases are not generally so friendly to one another. So you have this agnostic phase, which just says kind of like, yeah, I believe that there's something. You know, I believe there's something, but I don't want to get religious about it. You know, I don't want to go to the second phase. I believe there's something better. There's something holistic. You know, kind of vaguely holistic. I'm after this. This is sort of the first phase. I want something. I just don't want this primitive animalistic, you know, body worshiping, you know, nature worshiping, body worshiping, world worshiping, all this. I feel that there's something more inclusive, something greater, but I don't want to, you know, get religious about it. This is the first phase. So they're antagonistic to religion. Second phase is, we call religious phase, is where we start praying for it. We say, I really feel there is some divinity, and I really feel this divinity can somehow lift the suffering off of me. And I feel if I just pray and propitiate and, you know, ask, please, 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 that all the suffering of mortality will somehow be lifted off of me. And I have a savior. I have a, you know, whether it be, you know, each religion tends to have a central figurehead, right? Someone I can pray to, some focus for prayer that I feel is be effective, helps focus in. And this phase is antagonistic to the third phase, as well as to the first phase. They say, no, it's agnostic, that they're not with it. And the third phase is, oh, no, they're crazy, what are they? Arrogant, you know, they call it arrogance. Remember, setting down arrogance is not arrogant. But what they really mean is, whoa, that's too close to setting down pretending. I don't want to go there. I know, it's too scary. So eventually, the frustration that asking for all this suffering to be lifted off you doesn't really work so much. You might have some instances of an illness disappears, etc. But the overall weight of our misery does not really get lifted off of us this way. Then eventually you get into the third phase, which is directly asserting for yourself that I know that truth is true, nothing else is true. I know that truth is true and nothing else is true. This would be like A Course in Miracles be an example of great third phase teaching. It's really centered in the third phase. It helps us get out of the second phase into the third phase. Now, once you've really, really, really taken this third phase the right way, asserting positive assertions. Yes, I know eternal life is the only life there is, and I am that eternal life. I know the eternal life is the only life there is, and I am that eternal life. This gives you this, you know, and you have to work at this to gradually evaporate your continuity fear. In this phase, kind of looks down on the second phase. It's like, wow, you know, that's really dualistic, and that's not really where it's at. But it also looks at the fourth phase like, I don't know what you're talking about, you know. not really. I'm not really interested in that. That it's very vague, you know. So the third phase has to mature. When the third phase matures, then you're able to get into the fourth phase. And the fourth phase has a different understanding, because then in hindsight, it looks at all the phases and says, oh, they're all good, because they were all necessary. These steps were necessary. And I don't need to repeat them. Of course you don't need to repeat the steps. That's just absurdum. Complete absurdity. repetitive absurdum. Repetition absurdum. Because once the continuity, the goal is to burn away the continuity fear. Once you burn away the continuity fear, then you can set pretending down even. By right use of this practice, this. But it doesn't make any sense for people in the first, second, or third phase to do this practice. They need to practice where they're at. The common denominator in all the practices is that we deserve something better. We really deserve something way better. There is something way better. Ideally, you want all those four stages to respect one another. It doesn't really work out that way. It never has on this planet. Oftentimes the fourth phase needs to be very much under, you know, very quiet about it, and because the other phases don't like it and gang up on it. Even the assertion phase needs to be. So what you see in the religions, that there's these, they kind of have these different areas. And you might have, like in Christianity, you have the monastics, renunciates, you know, that spend their time isolated in, you know, in monasteries, etc., that really don't have too much to do with those in the second phase who are going to church, religiously going to church and praying for miracles and looking for the saints, the bones of the saints and relics and things, hoping that this can lift some of the misery of mortal mind off of themselves, this dream of mortality. And they don't really interact too much. They might interact a little bit with those who are advanced second phasers, or even some third phasers. They view the third phasers as, you know, saints, but they're scared, very scared of the fourth phase. They don't want to even know about it. So, you know, you can't really integrate this. You really cannot integrate it, because the continuity fear, you know, prevents it. So, it's a bit ragged, but it's right. And so the problem that what we have is the ego, we long for peace of mind, right? And what the ego tells us is, hey, you can just integrate mortal mind. You see, the ego says, look at all these problems religion has. It's ragged, you have these different conflicts, etc. And the ego says, you know, we could have a civilization, society, And it's all just, you know, integrated, homogenized, and we won't have this conflict. So if we just get rid of religion, we won't have any of this conflict. This is the trick that the ego is playing on everyone now. What you'll have is just this horrible gilded stone age, homogenized, where there's no cream rising to the top at all, and you just get this blandness. This terrible blandness, where everybody's just like not even allowed to start the first phase, and so they just have this unrecognized and denied longing within them. It's really based, the ego's belief in building a great civilization, a great secular humanist culture, civilization, world, is you end up with this unacknowledged longing, which is really the longing for the first phase to get started. And you end up taking drugs and drugs and drugs and sex and music and entertainment, and you're just trying to be happy But it's this whole civilization of secular humanism is based on denying the whole spiritual path altogether, especially the first phase, with this longing. So they try to prevent you. They try to bring you all back into this longing, and then they try to give an alternative to this longing, say, hey, we have a better way. This longing wasn't based on anything in the first place. It's just a myth. So if they get rid of the saviors, those the fourth phasers, the ones who've completed the fourth phase, the fourth phasers, the third phasers, and ultimately then they were able to get rid of the second phasers, then they reduce it all down to just the first phase of longing. And then they can say, hey, we have a way to fulfill your longing, which is sex, drugs, rock and roll, basically. This is, materialism. Then they're able to collapse the whole structure of spiritual aspiration and momentum towards liberation. So this is what's going on in the world. This is what's happening here. The secular humanists are collapsing this whole structure of spiritual momentum. And the idea that there's some savior that can come in and just save us all from this is not realistic at all. Because we pointed out that the four phases don't get along with one another. They struggle, and it's ragged because of the severity of the continuity fear. There's no way around that. You cannot just pull ourselves up by our bootstraps. It just doesn't. It will never work. So you have to have this overall culture of forgiveness and compassion for the struggles, the religious, the spiritual path struggles that we go through. And there has to be sort of a general acceptance of this in culture and society that there are these phases that you go through. And so the idea that somehow we're going to have this spiritual enlightenment on this planet is nonsense. Those who are saying that are the secular humanists. And what they really mean is they're going to get rid of the whole spiritual path and fulfill this longing that they claim is not really longing for eternal life, but longing for material comfort. You see, and then they'll say, we're supplying the material comfort. This is what's going to make you happy. This is what they really mean as the planet is going to go through some ascension, spiritual enlightenment. It means getting rid of the whole spiritual path. They think that this is going to bring us a millennial happiness, because then we'll finally be able to function on focus on creature comforts, creature comforts, creature comforts, creature comforts, which is what all this technology is also very much part of roboticism, of let us produce, endless creature comforts. So, I mean, every time I go into a store, I try not to go into stores, but when I get dragged into one, you can't help but notice everything has changed since the last time you're there. Constant repackaging and I remember I brought my uncle into some stores, and he didn't get out very much. And he went around and he didn't recognize any. He said, I don't recognize anything in this store. Virtually nothing is recognizable. And it freaked him out. And even now, if we don't go in a store for 4 months, 6 months, you go in there, all the products have changed. See, where are all the products that I'm familiar with? They're all gone, replaced by something else. This is the plan is just continually replace products, repackage, 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 restyle, restyle, restyle. And this is designed to make us think that we're getting something, like we're getting catered to. And we think that being catered to, materially catered to, is going to make us happy. New coffee beans. These coffee beans were raised in a different way. We got a couple million different, microclimates we've identified for coffee beans, and you're able to select and blend these million different microclimate beans in, infinite different ways. So you wake up in the morning and you say, wow, I'm getting, I'm getting this ultra special a blend of microclimate beans in this ultra special machine that is able to somehow, vaporize the beans and then condense the vaporization, and give an even specialer blend of this. This is where we're already at, basically. And so I'm sipping this cup of coffee, and I feel like I'm being supremely catered to. You know, materially, my body is being supremely catered to. And we even, we have like these spectrometers or something that is actually able to tell us, you know, exactly. They'll give us an actual video, you know, of the microclimate where this bean came from. We'll be able to see this. And then the composition and the history of the microclimate, you know, and the composition of the soil, and, you know, we'll have all these specs, you know, infinite specs about everything, data about everything. And so this is all feeling that we're being catered to, infinitely catered to. This is what is going on this planet right now. And some people aren't interested in that. Those who have taken the spiritual path, they're not interested in that. But it's very seductive. Once you try to collapse the momentum and compassion and forgiveness and tolerance of the spiritual culture, of course, spiritual culture is not tolerant of having spiritual culture collapsed. That's the one intolerance it has to have, obviously. Otherwise, it would be an absurdity. So when spiritual culture says, hey, we don't want to be collapsed, secular, humanistic, materialistic culture says, oh, you're very intolerant. You're extremely intolerant, extremely bigoted, extremely racist, extremely... So all the mechanisms that they're using to collapse the spiritual culture, which has inherent momentum in it, they always say, well, your resistance to this means that you're bigoted, you know, you're racist, you're homophobic, you're, you know, sexist, you're this, whatever. What they're saying is, you know, you're intolerant of having your culture collapsed, which is an absurdity. You know, I mean, if someone believes that their culture is valuable, how can you say that they're wicked and evil to keep, you know, to say, hey, I don't want my culture, this culture collapsed. I find it valuable. And it's an absurdity to say that, you know, they're intolerant, you know. And so we have to unearth this fundamental absurdity of humanistic secular materialism, which again is all about catering to the body, to the so-called evidence of mortality, is in thinking, how cool is this? You know, you know, I saw this, I was at a car dealership recently, and they're showing me all the new cars, you know, and it's, they're catering to you. I mean, I got into behind the steering wheel, this new luxury vehicle, and the steering wheel, I could hardly recognize, you couldn't hardly even see the steering wheel because of all the bells and whistles on it. I said, I don't want this is ridiculous. It's a standard transmission, except you've got these paddles on it, shifting paddles on it. And so you can pretend you can go into, you know, Ferrari mode, shifting paddles. But the whole steering wheel and the hub of it is studded with buttons of all these different systems that you can, you know, play. I just want a steering wheel. I just want a steering wheel. The other lower model was just a steering wheel. I said, that, you know, I want a steering wheel. But you see, they're catering to us. The whole thing about this, what's happening in this world, is they're catering to our vanities and creature comforts and mortality, saying, don't worry, Bill can cater to you. So they have, you know, the tires monitor the tire pressure at all times. And even when you're filling up the tire, the lights flash to let you know that you have the right amount in your tire. And pretty soon they'll have automatically... they may probably already have it where the tires are automatically filled. Though this is all very nice, but it's catering. See, this just is catering to our creature comforts, which I don't like. And people say, well, you're not going to have creature comforts. I say, well, you have some, but you don't have this ideology, this religion of catering to it. You don't have it. And the great spiritual teachers who have completed the fourth phase and completely graduated, they tell us, be very, very careful about creature comforts and refuse to get sucked into this. This is what will pull you down. Be austere. It's not austerity, as if austerity is some magical potion or something. This is what Buddha understood. He says, yes, the middle path, meaning don't go into practices of mortification. No. It's just a way to avoid getting hooked on the ego's plan. So you're not fanatical about it. But for me, I'd be perfectly happy to have an old-style car, you know, 67 or something, with, you know, no bells and whistles, really. Just maybe a few. Maybe air conditioning would be nice. It's nice. Okay, fine. But we didn't used to have air conditioning. The windows were air conditioning. Roll the windows down. But I was perfectly happy with that. We just rolled the windows down. We didn't have any. It's not feeling like, oh, we're so deprived. This is terrible. We're not being catered to. I say, no, this is nice. This is enough. This is enough. But I don't like the new cars. Tell you the truth, I was, like I said, I was just in some super duper, you know, top of the line. This is it. This has got all the bells and whistles, side cameras, rear cameras, driving cameras, so that if you fall asleep, it keeps you in the lane. You know, you start drifting, it'll keep you back in the lane. Everything, all the bells and whistles, and I didn't like the car. I said, no, I'd rather have a 1967 car. Very much so, because you're completely out of control. The car is just like, not impressed at all. I said, this is just spiritually depraved. I mean, we're going in this direction of just this obscene catering to the belief in mortal life, catering to our pretension. We're just catering to our pretension. Now, I'll drive the car, you know, wouldn't Rome do as Romans do? Because these maniacs are, the way they're driving now, to drive at 67 is, you know, it's difficult. It would be difficult. Everyone would have to slow down. But I mean, we cruised, you know, 60 or 55, 60. We weren't weaving through traffic, you know. And it was great. It was great. I loved it. Way better than now. If, you know, I would take the 60s over these times now, for sure. In fact, it's appearing to be vastly superior than what we have now. And this is helpful to have somebody who's lived in different eras, you know, before this high-tech catering came in. And I realized how it was vastly better back then. There's no question. Is it perfect? Oh, no. Ragged, for sure. But the spirit that we had back then was vastly superior than what we have now. Now everybody are just materialistic pigs, and gimme, I want, you know. It's just unbelievable how much catering, cosmetic surgery, this and that. You know, extreme catering to, and the healthcare industry, you know, is just offering us this endless amenities, endless innovation, endless repackaging, endless this. This is a false religion. This is the Antichrist religion of the ego. This is what it is. If people are looking for the Antichrist, this is the Antichrist religion of the ego. This secular humanist materialism of catering to the belief in the mortal self, you know, mortal identity. That's the Antichrist. That is the false direction, the false teaching. And what's happening, they're trying to set up a system which crushes religion, which crushes all of this. And they are doing that. They absolutely are doing that. Now, in the 60s, for instance, we were catered to, sure, in a certain way. But it wasn't, you know, it wasn't overblown like it is. It hadn't reached the levels of absurdity which we've entered. But certainly people like to be catered to. I mean, you know, ladies love going to the beauty parlor and getting all these Shirley Temple girls and being dolled up, you know. Of course they did. As did the grandmothers before then, too. I mean, a visit to the beauty parlor was, you know, essential. Just like, okay, they got catered to there. You're so beautiful. I'm going to make you so beautiful, you know. Let's make you look beautiful. Oh, thank you. You're catering to mortality. Now, the hippie movement was, there was a revolt against that. And the women stopped going to the beauty parlors, you know. They just stopped dolling themselves up. The 50s was very dolled up. The 60s was, you know, it's always the women that lead culture. And they decided, hey, you know, too much catering. We don't want this. It's too much. That lasted for a little while, you know. And then, but, you know, this is a problem. You might say women are very fickle. They like to be catered to. And so when they decided, oh, we don't want to be catered to anymore, the guy said, okay, you know, we're going along with this. And then when they started having children and, you know, then they said, you know, I kind of want a house. This, you know, living in a tent isn't so cool. I want a house. Yeah. And, well, gee, I need a house. I kind of want a car, you know. And then so bit by bit by bit, all the hippie women went materialistic. In hindsight, you can see it's happened. You know, very few, you know, stuck with their guns. Some did, but didn't really satisfy them because, you know, it's not an end in itself. Keep this in mind. This is austerity is not an end in itself. And if you simply go hippie and think that's an end in itself, it doesn't work. Hindsight shows us this for sure. But the women did go hippie for a while. And they promised the guys, hey, I'm not going to be materialistic. You don't have to get a job. You don't have to make all this money. I'm happy just living in a tent. I'm happy just hitchhiking. I'm happy just planting a little garden. You know, I don't need all this materialistic stuff. You don't have to be a wage slave. You don't have to go in the corporate world and be a wage slave. And so the guys, you know, said, oh, wow, great. So we can focus on the spiritual path. They said, yeah, we us too. Let's do our OM. Let's do our meditation. Everything that's cool. And then here comes the babies, you know, and babies, oh, cry, oh, what do I do? You know, how can I help the children? I need to take care of their medical things. And of course, some of them did try to stick their guns. And those are the ones that are being pressured, targeted. You know, your kid's got to get all these inoculations, and your kid has to go to school and everything. So, you know, what happened was, again, that they started saying to the guys, hey guys, you know, I need a little more money. And what happened was the guys who were told, yeah, no, don't worry, I'm not gonna put any demands on you, materialistic demands. When the demands started getting put on them, and they themselves were not, they didn't go corporate, so they dropped out. You know, famous Timothy Leary, turn on and drop out. Well, a lot of us did that. And then when the women started making demands, like, hey, you know, I need to, you know, they've got a, you know, baby and another one on the way, and you know, wow, we need some money. And the guy started dealing drugs is what happened. Because they couldn't function in the corporate world anymore. And so a lot of drug dealing started taking place. Yeah, this drug culture arose. And of course, drug culture is a great excuse, you know, not to go corporate. You know, you say, well, I'm too high for that. I'm just telling it like it is. This is what's necessary. We need something very straightforward and honest about the world situation. Now, let me put it this way. The women going, you know, dropping out and going, you know, dropping out the, you know, the catering to their materiality, going hippie. The women going hippie. Let's put it that way. in the 60s, late 50s, 60s, and early 70s, it lasted about that long. This was helpful. Okay, let me put it this way. So, I very much appreciate that. The fact that they were not able to stick to their guns because of the insane pressure that they were put under. Because keep in mind that corporations market to women. And the last thing the corporations want women doing is going hippie. They're absolutely, but they have to be very careful. You know, they got to cater. They have to know how to cater to the psychology of women. And so the corporations became geniuses in this. They're very smart, the corporations and marketing. They studied female psychology. This is a very key aspect of their marketing. They hired geniuses, 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 geniuses. And they said, how do we market to these women? They want to go hippie. We don't want them going hippie. And so they, through all their money and their marketing, were able to gradually break down female resistance. And they went back and went, you know, females went corporate again. I mean, materialistic. However, there was this time where men were able to, that the pressure was taken off of their heads, okay? Because in the 50s, the pressure on men was insane. It's, you know, the woman is a housewife, she's going to pop out 4 to 6 kids. You go to work to a corporation, and you supply all material wants for your wife and the kids, and that's your life, period. That's it. Excuse me. That was the narrative. The narrative was very cut and dried, very strong. You did not deviate from that narrative, period. Very buttoned down. And the women, seeing their mothers, they said, wow, that's not really fulfilling. You know, this material existence is terrible. We don't really like this. So they rebelled. And again, women always are the ones driving the vehicle of culture in the world, always. The way it is in nature, the way things are set up, that women take the lead, they tell the man, and if they want the man to take the lead, the women say, look, I'm telling you to take the lead. So they're still driving. They're just saying, I'm telling you, I want you to, you know, I'm telling you what to do. Women always tell men what to do. And so in the 60s, and in this hippie era, like, we could sit there and read spiritual books and meditate and contemplate and not go to school, not do our homework, and not look for a job. And the women would say, great, no problem. It's not a problem for me. In fact, this is wonderful. They expected us. They said, wow, you're my hero. I mean, look at this. You're rebelling against corporate culture. This is great. So I grew up in an era where it was okay to do that. So that's what I did. I didn't pay any attention to my homework at all. I didn't go for good grades. I didn't participate in all this extracurricular and corporate stuff that, you know, trying to put you in the narrative. And I did spend my time reading all these spiritual books and meditating and contemplating, constantly focusing on this. I did not develop any skills, corporate skills at all. I did not go out looking for jobs at all. I spent all my time focused on spiritual truth. But the truth be told, although the women talked a good game, hippie game, it was mostly, they, you know, it didn't take much to say, hey, you know, they look at this car and they see some corporate woman, you know, driving by. Their boyfriend has this new Ford, you know, new 67 Ford or whatever. It's like, oh my gosh, you know, wow. They start thinking, I kind of like to have a ride like that too. And look at the clothes she's wearing. Oh my. And they're going on vacation. And it didn't take long before they say, wow. No, I want a guy with some money in his pocket, plain and simple. And so what happened was you really ended up, you know, being ostracized, you know, more and more, you know, and there are fewer and fewer hippie women. That's what happened. The girls were less and less and less. They liked playing the part, you know, for a while. But when they started seeing, you know, they started thinking, okay, I have children, what kind of house, you know, and so they talked a good game. But some of them were genuine about it, really, to as much as they could be. But the very effort to survive as a hippie required so much effort that it was very difficult to focus on the spiritual path, doing it that way, actually. You know, it was difficult, very difficult. And you had to really buy in, really, really buy in. And there's so many drugs involved. and diseases, and it was a rough, rough go because the however, there was this time where we could breathe a little bit. Men could breathe. Okay. Generally, men can't breathe at all in this world. Women hold the whip over them so severely, so severely. Today, oh my gosh, it's hideous. You just talk to men and they're like zombies, basically burned out zombies. And they're just dominated by women, so severely dominated by them. And they're saying, the women are saying, I want to be catered to. I am not being catered to enough. And I'm not happy. And this whole situation is, you're just not bringing me enough. I want more, more, more. And they're becoming, as a young man told me, they're just becoming gross. The grotesque. They really are. And men are just looking like, wow. I talk to them, they say, there's nothing we can do. My life is just, it's hell, and will never change. So, these are facts. These are facts. We need to look at it. However, you know, let us say this. It's very important that you have an ally here. Everybody has an ally here. Because I am appreciative of what happened in the 60s and the breathing space that the women gave us back then, you see. They did give us a little breathing space. Now, they may not know this, you see. They may think, oh, they may have forgotten this. So they may not realize that they did something really good. And this may bear fruit, you know. And this situation here may be some of the fruit that is born from that. So I actually have a better perspective on women than almost anyone, because they did something really good for me, you see. Whereas most people, deep down, they do not really have a good... Even women don't like women. It's the truth. It's the truth. They just are sharing secrets about how to be catered to, you know. But really deep down, they're saying, wow, I don't really like this at all. I don't really like women either. I don't like men. I'd like women, you know. But from a man's... And most men, let me tell you, most men don't like women at all. They're just imprisoned by them. Plain and simple. Do prisoners really like the, you know, those who are imprisoning them? No. No. They just have to say, yes, dear, smile, yes, dear, you want this, yes, dear, you know, okay, you know, like this. I mean, this is what's really going on. We need to just, you know, acknowledge it. There's no love lost at all between the genders, not at all. It's vicious. It's a vicious exploitation. You know, this whole, again, based on this, the ego saying, you know, that the Antichrist teachings of catering to mortality is the way to be happy. So, you know, we all talk a good game, but usually it's very superficial. But the middle path, the way of, you know, don't go into severe austerities like the hippies did, nor go into severe catering to mortal. You know, I can make mortal existence wonderful. You see, neither one of those ways really is pragmatically helpful. So I tried to take a middle path where I tried not to fall, you know, too far in either way. And I'd go one a little bit this way, a little bit that way, a little bit this way, a little bit that way, by trying to kind of keep in the middle there. So I was able to continually keep focusing on spiritual truth all the time. I kept going, didn't stop. Now, of course, when the hippie women stopped being hippie women, I was then, you know, didn't exist anymore, because I had, you know, didn't have the tools to cater to the new woman, the material obsessed woman. I didn't exist at all, and it's amazing. You're not on the radar. You have no value to society whatsoever anymore. And really, the way, if you really want to be a hippie woman, just don't have kids. But you see, that's where they draw the line, basically. But once you have kids, it's a different story. But I just said, well, if you really want to, you know, get free of this antichrist, secular, materialistic, humanistic, false belief system, having kids is a big problem. Having kids is going to be a big problem for you. And there's not a lot of women who are willing to go that far. And even the ones that do, they think that then, well, that they should be extra catered to materialistically. Says, well, I gave up having children, so I want to be the child, and I want to have everything. I want to go on vacations constantly. I want beautiful cars, beautiful houses. You know, you got to make it up to me. Well, this course, of course, completely defeats everything. So very few women are willing to be poor, you know, not materially catered to, and also not have children, and be able to then focus on spiritual truth. You know, that's very rare, actually. However, you see, what women have forgotten about is the men who were able to breathe a little bit and get some spiritual oxygen into their being from what they did. They made an effort, you know. Whether it was sincere or not, you know, it doesn't matter, because pragmatically it was effective. See, we must realize that we're in a pragmatic situation, and we need not worry about idealism here. So whatever their motivation was, it was just rebellion, whatever it was, we don't need to evaluate that. We only need to see, was there some effectiveness, pragmatic effectiveness of it? And I say there was. I'm an example of it. So I know the world thinks that it's sunk, you know, it's sunk. And not entirely true, not entirely true. I don't want that music from getting grabbed by Google. They grab it if it's some mile away, some song, they'll grab it and say, you know, you it's copyrighted. It's ridiculous. They have to be way more sensitive to common sense than that. If there's some background music that's very fuzzy and very vague, they shouldn't copyright flag it. That's ludicrous. You know, it's ludicrous. I mean, I'm sure there's going to be some people exploit loopholes, they always do. But they just say, oh, this is just ambient background stuff, you know. And, you know, that's not a copyright infringement. It's just stupid. The algorithms are stupid. A lot of stupidity, unfortunately, at Google, as they frantically try to find the next way to cater, you know, to our mortality. That their Google Plus, their Google Hangouts are a joke. I tried to join one. I cannot get on. Been jumping through so many hoops and problems, and ultimately the camera finally goes on, but it says, you're ready to go live. You never go live. The internet connection drops out. I mean, it's just so non-user friendly. It's just a joke. You wonder why Google Hangouts isn't more effective, because who can even get on those things? I'm having the most terrible time. I can't get on them. You can't ask people to jump through those hoops and torture themselves like that. I mean, it would be easy to put this technology. I mean, this technology is not difficult, really. I mean, they make it more difficult than it needs to be. Too many bells and whistles. You know, just get something that works. Forget about all these. Well, you can get this applause, and you can throw pictures in, and you can blah, blah. They make it so difficult that the basic functionality doesn't even work. This is ludicrous. 1 minute, please. Okay, good luck. All right. Too much. Like I said, you know, if something isn't broken to an engineer, it means it doesn't have enough features on it. I mean, I'm sure they're pretty happy. Say, hey, it doesn't work. Google Plus doesn't work. Google Hangouts doesn't work. And I can say, wow, that's great. We must have really overloaded it, huh? Idiots. Just make the basic functionality work. We just want to have a video, and then other people can listen into the video. That's it. We don't need all this sophistication, which causes all these software incompatibilities, and on and on and on and on. Greater bandwidth. You need a faster, you know, system. Faster. It's always you need a faster system. is catering, catering, catering. It's this. It's the religion of catering to the belief in mortal life. It constantly causes these problems. You always have to kind of be upgrading, upgrading, upgrading. And if you don't, your stuff doesn't work anymore. This is a nightmare. Do you not understand? I'm sure everybody realizes this is a nightmare. And I realized this quite some time ago, that I'm not going to keep chasing the dragon of technology, because I understood what it's about. I'm not going to get a smartphone, because the people do have them tell me you always have to keep upgrading the next one, you know, and it's just you get hooked into the whole system of being catered to. What do you think smartphones are for? Catering to mortal existence. Of course. You know, you can locate, you know, all the pizza shops in your area and look at the menus of all of them right where you're sitting. What's happening? You're being catered to. You're being catered to. Your belief in mortal existence is being catered to, and this gives you this egoic high. The people in the world now are extreme egotists. And the ego, again, we will not allow it to play this card. Oh, like, well, you have to be some super austere person, otherwise you can't talk, you know. We've already debunked that nonsense, that extremes only get in the way. Being like an extreme hippie is so difficult. You don't even have time for spiritual practice. So what we are is that we're extreme pragmatists. Right? It's pragmatism that wins the day, not idealism. The ego insists it would be idealism. We say, no, ego, you're an idiot. You don't know, the ego doesn't know what it's talking about. So I don't want to be catered to that level. Absolutely not. I don't even like, you know, cell phones. I even feel, well, I know where that's going, and that leads to too much catering. I mean, I was happy with just call phones, you know. We had telephone booths on every corner. If you wanted to make a call to somebody, you drop a dime and make a call. Everything functioned beautifully, actually, back then. And people that were so egomaniacs that we have in the world now, millennials are egomaniacs, to be honest. A lot of them. Means that they know nothing but being catered to, and the technology exists to cater to me, of course. And the more is better. More catering is better. And we want to sit here. We want to see, you know, 20 pizza shops. We want to know exactly what the pizzas are. And then we want to just digitally place an order. We don't want to even talk to a person. Why do we even need to talk to a person? I want to be catered to even more than that. I want a machine catering toward me. We just text our order in, and then it just shows up delivered, ultimately delivered by a drone. Soon they're going to that level. And the pizza delivery, you know, guy pulls up. There you go, you know, and it's already paid for online or whatever. Ah, look how great I'm being catered to, and I'm eating this pizza. You know, it's like, you know, I'm awesome. You know, how much awesomeness is this? This is these morons, okay, in the world. They're morons, egomaniac, egomaniacal morons, okay? And this is not a put-down. It's just telling it like it is. This is helpful for people to hear this. And they might be shocked to think, the problem is they think that those who do not go into this level of being catered to are primitives or something, or like, they're stupid. How wrong can they possibly be? No, they're wise. They're way more advanced. It's this being catered to, it's this religion of the ego, which is the Stone Age. It's a spiritual Stone Age win right now. And yet they all think they're going into this millennium where everybody will be like super catered to. Yeah, I can be on the beach and I can have this drone just deliver a pizza to me right on the beach. You know, I can be out in the jungle and a drone will deliver me a pizza in the jungle. Absolutely. We'll be hiking up in the mountains and we say, you know what, I feel like a pizza. Okay, no problem. There's this down in the valley, 60 miles away, there's a pizza place. Okay, I'll just text here. Of course, we'll, you know, have a satellite phone or whatever, and there's cell towers everywhere, whatever. But we have a signal, so we'll text in our order, and of course, our phone has a smartphone, has a GPS on it, right? So the drone then just hooks onto our GPS, and you're up there on, you know, up there on some granite boulder in the, you know, 60 miles back in the wilderness, just looking out over a lake, you know, this is great, you know. And then, here comes my drone, you know. Oh, here comes our pizza. And the drone comes and delivers, comes right down and sets down I don't know how they'll do it, how they'll actually have some, like, an arm that'll probably extend to you, and there's your pizza, and you take the pizza, and thank you, drone, and maybe give it a tip, or you text a tip in, that's already covered, right? Service charge, drone service charge. And you take the pizza out of the box, the insulating box, and you put it upon the granite, the wonderful granite you might have, oh, that's cool. And the drone takes the packaging back or whatever, Or maybe the drone waits until you've finished your pizza and napkins and everything, and then you put all the napkins and make the little package, The drone has like a evacuation package where you, then all the trash is now, the drone takes the trash back to the pizzeria. And so you don't even have to worry about packing out your trash. And you say, oh, wow. This is the life of Riley. I'm being so catered to. Don't think for one instant that this is exactly what the millennials are aiming for in this world. It's exactly what they're all about. My generation, not so much. Me, not at all. What I want is an entire realm that completely caters to the belief in eternal life. That's what I want. That's how I want to be catered to. Very different than what the millennials are after. So for me, it would be like, I don't even feel hunger. So what do I need a pizza for? I don't even feel discomfort. So what do I need these comforts for? I feel perfect. All the world, everything I see is flawless, it's perfect, it's beautiful. And if I want it to appear in any different way, it'll instantly appear in some other way, So truly reality actually completely caters to us. So we're used to being perfectly catered to. Whereas here we're trying to cater to mortality. We're trying to cater and make that be happy with that. But this will never work for us. So this is why, because we're fundamentally created as eternal life and the living light reality completely caters to any experience we want to have perfectly and endlessly without ever being burned out or getting tired of it. That nothing less than this will ever satisfy us. So the idea that we can be satisfied by catering to mortality is an absurdity. And it ends up in these obsessions of being catered to. And this is why this present civilization is obsessed with technology and it's how can I be catered to? And smartphones are the very heart of this religion, New World Order religion, of being catered to, mortality being catered to, which is why I don't have a smartphone. Because once you get one, you realize, they're constantly showing you ways to be catered. Hey, try this, you can do this, look at this. And then we can upgrade this and be even more catered to, and you get insidiously pulled into it. Of course, we already have all the, packaging, UPS and DHL, and there's a lot of other ones, right, that are, and you got Amazon, you need to order stuff and wherever, from everywhere in the world, and they'll get it to you real quickly. We used to have ships that took longer, and then there's air freight, and now we have, all the super air freight, and you can order something, and boom, pay extra, and it's delivered to your door that day. This is the religion of being catered to. Mortality being catered to. This is the egoic antichrist religion, which says, hey, don't worry about eternal life. That's just a myth. It doesn't exist. You really are mortal existence. But this longing you had to be catered to, we can fulfill that here. That's not a problem. Oh, yeah, but all the resources of the planet are getting used. Oh, well, I guess we better find another planet. Oh, okay, we need to, build a space fleet, and that's, because we're going to eventually run out of stuff here. And but you take someone who's graduated from the fourth phase of practice, and they don't need to be catered to, really. Like Ron Maharshi, holy cow. He catered to everybody else, He didn't say, this body doesn't have any needs. I don't feel any needs at all. I'm being perfectly catered to by eternal life. And we call that selflessness or something. But no, it's not selflessness. It's selfness. True selfness. Meaning the true self caters to my spirit perfectly. So what do I need this ridiculous farce of trying to cater to mortal, this illusory mirage of mortal existence, trying to be satisfied with this absurdity, catering to that? I don't even need that. It's ridiculous. So again, this is a stone age, gilded stone age. And it's been going on. This has been going on throughout history. It's just we're reaching new levels of being catered to and bringing it to the masses. Whereas like in the past, the French in Paris would go to the Grandier Opera House or something this opulence, unbelievable opulence, and they're being catered to. They sit in these plush chairs and they see the opera, this great show, and they feel, my mortality is being so catered to. This is very satisfying. This is very important. I'm being so catered to by these just extreme opulence. But of course, only the wealthy, could afford to be catered to like that. But now, we're being told everybody can get a smartphone. Everybody can get in on this being catered to. We're spreading the gospel of the Antichrist to everyone in this world. And you get all these people, and the millennials, so to speak, including, Generation X, those who have grown up in this high-tech catering environment, that's all they know, all these princes and princesses, they think they're, so special. I'm so special. Look, I'm being catered to. And then they expect to be catered to spiritually as well. They're so spoiled. And they think spirituality is just another way of catering to mortality. And if it isn't, what use is it? There's no use. So, the thing is I've said that the people of today, and of course those drive the engine of culture are the women, are vicious. Where I experienced a time when they were not quite as vicious. Which is a good thing, because the men of today, how are they really going to turn things around? They're not. The answer is they're not. The best they can peddle is some sort of hybrid saying, guess what, ladies, you can have non-dual realization and also be super materially catered to. Oh my gosh, the catering, you're going to prosperity affirmations, combine prosperity affirmation with non-dual awareness and you got the perfect new age religion, The lady will say, oh yeah, I like this. That's very attractive. We can have our cake and eat it too. But Jesus points out, of course, miracles, that's not it. That is not it at all. He says, the body, properly seen, has no needs at all. No needs at all. You don't even see the body. It's not about combining the two, the ego and the Holy Spirit, as some spiritual teachers are now saying, this is where it's at. That is not where it's at. But they'll keep playing their games, and we'll see if any, maybe something pragmatic can come out of that, But because, You know, what else are the millennials going to do? I mean, they're so hooked on being catered to, this idea of being catered to. How can they just drop it? You know, they just think that spirituality is another form of being catered to. And so, what can you do? I mean, I'm just bringing the straight truth here. And how many, you know, millennials are interested in this? Virtually very few, if any, right? Very few. And the older people are just, you know, like, wow, we're on our way out. And they're just kind of numb. They're numb. I talk to older people, my generation, and they see, you know, they understand, but they just shrug their shoulders and says, wow, you know, what can you do? But maybe something can be done. Maybe something we don't know entirely. We don't know if a great teacher were to show up, you know, what would happen. Maybe there would be. Maybe some millennials, maybe some older generation, premillennial. We call them premillennials, not older. I don't like that term. No, we have millennials and premillennials. Okay, basically. The premillennials were wiser than the millennials, I can tell you that. The millennials are not wise. They lack wisdom. They are hell-bent on the egoic plan. Not all of them. Some of them have been there and done that and saying, you know, I'm tired of this. This doesn't really work. And yet they, you know, they keep doing it. When in Rome, do as Romans do. So they might have their smartphone. That's you know, it's understandable. It's not. I'm not saying that nobody should have smartphones. If you're a millennial, you probably should have a smartphone. Okay, but for me, I understand. You know, don't even get into it at all. This is a higher standard. Just a higher recognition. Wow, I'm fortunate enough to know where to draw the line. But, you know, millennial may say, yeah, I've got all this catering. But you know what? That's not where it's at. It's really not where it's at. But I got to at least, you know, keep some face with, you know, my generation. So I'll go through the motions and pretend and stuff. But I'm really, really not into that, actually. This, I know it doesn't work. So that's absolutely possible. Absolutely possible. But I would suggest, do not go into affirmations of material success and well-being and those kind of things. I know there's some very popular spiritual teachers in a way that promote this, but I would suggest avoiding that. Okay. Now, it may be that that's what millennials believe in, so you might do a little of that. Okay. Again, when in Rome, do as Romans do. Just like for me, you know, I tried to stay sort of in the middle ground, not, you know, being too conspicuous one way or the other, right? So I try to look a little bit corporate, a little bit hippie. I go ping-pong back between the two, you know, and say, I'm a hippie corporatist, or I'm a corporate hippie, or, you know, what are you, you know? Like, there's still guys that have their ponytail and stuff, but they went corporate. They say, what did you do? Well, yeah, I was tech. Okay, so, yeah, I mean, they made their fortune. I know people that had hair down to their you know, their back. I mean, all the way down their back and leather coat. I mean, hippied out, drugs, music, sex, drugs, rock and roll, hippied out. Just, hey, I'm not corporate. And then they at some point they said, uh-oh, you know, they met a girlfriend or something who said, I kind of like, you know, shoes and dresses and, hey, let's have a good time, but yeah, I need a new dress. And before you know it, they were in IT, you know. But they said, oh, don't worry, you can still be a hippie and still, you know, you can have your cake at it too. You can be hippie and corporate and make a lot of money. You just build these gadgets for us. And so that's what they did. And they got the girl, they got the house, but they got to keep the long hair. You know, kind of a Pyrrhic victory there, right? I mean, think about it. They got to keep the long hair. Didn't get to keep anything else. Well, you get to keep the long hair on the guitar, but not anything else. But me, I was able to keep everything. And after a while, I realized I was able to keep everything, so I don't need the long hair, I don't need the guitar, I don't need this stuff. You know, why not appear to be a little bit more corporate, et cetera, et cetera? Because I know I'm able to keep all the momentum. So, just, you know, be pragmatic. So if you're millennial and you realize all this, then, you know, just be pragmatic. Don't think you have to be a hippie or compete with the 60s or, you know, compete. You don't have to compete. You just have to be really wise. Just minimize the use of the smartphone. Yeah, occasionally you send a picture, occasionally you send a tweet. I mean, I send a tweet, you know, you do that. But you understand, you know, that this is not where it's at all. And don't let it take your time up. Minimize it. Now, with corporations, what the corporate ego has done through corporations and marketing to women is they've changed all the laws. So it's made it seem so appealing for women to be these materialistic beings, demanding greater and greater and greater catering to. It's made it so attractive. They're trying desperately to buy their loyalty to corporations legally. So basically they said, look, you know, you got complete control over the man. We'll change the legal system. So, you know, like a guy said to me, you know, oh, my girlfriend can, you know, attack me, hit me over the head with a frying pan, stab me. I'm lying there bleeding, dying, whatever. And then she'll call the police. And what will happen, the police will automatically come to the door and arrest the man and put him in jail, period. And it's absolutely true. This is what happens. And the woman can just say, you know, he attacked me. And the man is always wrong, and the woman is always right. This is the corporate, this is the deal that women got. You know, the corporate said, hey, we'll make you always right. You're always right. No repercussions whatsoever. No responsibility, no repercussions. As long as you buy into the materialistic narrative that we want you to sell you. And this is what happened. I mean, look at the radical feminists. That, you know, we thought, they're really on the edge, really hip. No, they were just corporate shills, plain and simple. They say, we don't need men. You know what? Those radical feminists, they ended up marrying millionaires and living a very opulent, catered to life. This is a fact. They weren't the poor hippies. No, they were not. They were corporate shills. And their whole message was really to change the laws. They were really after changing the laws, which stripped men of any compensation as far as power goes and say goes and, you know, any equality. They were not for equality, they were for inequality. Radical feminism, his whole point is inequality among the sexes, domination by women. And this is the corporate culture, and which is the egoic religion. That's what they wanted, because they were terrified that women might go hippie on them, and they might, and women might say, hey, wait a minute, you know. They said, no, you can get the man to work for you, and if he rebels, then you can send him to jail. You got. So what happened? But right now, women have this legal guillotine over men, basically. You know, it's like every house has a guillotine set up in it. And women just point to that guillotine and say, hey, you don't do what I say, you know, there's the guillotine. Put your head on the block. Psychologically, every house has a guillotine in it now. And this is true. And men know it. And they're afraid to have their head chopped off. Because, you know, when women start feeling, I kind of feel like going hippie, you know, corporate says, hey, no, you got this, look at this new model of car, gotta go to this car dealer, take a look at this, I mean, it's amazing how we're catering to you. And then she gets in the car and says, oh my gosh, this is amazing, look what they've done this, and they've done this for my kids, there's a full entertainment center in back for my kids, and they thought my kids can stretch out and go to sleep, and do the, you know, I can put, the, you know, the babysitter, the, you know, the safe, you know, oh my gosh, this is amazing, you know, I think I want it. And they don't ever think like, well, who's going to pay for it? No, that's not important. What's important is I want it. And I get what I want. It's that simple. Well, who's going to get it? Well, the slaves. My slave will get it for me. Of course. And of course, in ancient times, this is exactly what slaves are all about. Their aristocracy, you see, those owned slaves says, I think I want to be catered to in this way. Slave, make it happen. And of course, if the slave didn't make it happen, they would be killed are severely punished. Plain and simple. Nowadays, we have the same sort of slavery going on right now. The idea that somehow we've freed ourselves from slavery is one of the big, big myths, lies. No, we have more slaves than ever on this planet. All the men of this planet are enslaved right now, as a matter of fact. And so they say, yep, I want the, yeah, I want, I like this. Yeah, this is what I want. This is how I want. This will make me happy. This will make me feel in alignment with this religion, my religion I have, which is this corporate secret humanism, corporate humanism. That's the God, the idol that the world is worshiping. They say, yeah, oh, this is how I buy this new car. I'm on the good side of it. Yeah, but it costs $50,000 in payments and insurance and upkeep and war. Oh, that's not my problem. That's my husband's problem. I mean, he'll deal with that. He'll deal with that. All I know is that I'm not going hippie. I'm spiritually aligned with what's right. I'm righteous. And this is what the corporations want me to be. They want me to be a righteous woman. And if I'm a righteous woman, they tell me my husband won't be happy by that. This is what makes my husband happy, is that I'm a righteous woman. He gets to cohabit with a righteous woman. And that's his reward. And so they don't even think anything further than that. The stress on the man, he's taking antidepressants, he's collapsing. They don't even think. So what do you mean? He's got this all important benefit of living with a righteous woman. What else could he possibly want? Plain truth, right? And this is this hideous mindset we have right now. And the men will say, well, wait a minute. He said, don't worry. If I'm catered to, you can enjoy being catered to also. And then women just say, well, this is what makes you happy. So basically they're controlling the narrative. Hey, men, this is what makes you happy. We know what makes you happy. Being catered to, your mortal existence being catered to. Well, you don't need to tell us. We already know. Corporations have told us that they're in touch with some higher ups, and we know. So you don't even need to tell us what makes you happy, because we already know. So they're completely shut off from even listening to men. When men say, I'm sick, I'm anxious, I'm depressed, I'm collapsing, I'm sick, I'm dying, I'm drinking alcohol, they say, well, I mean, I don't need to listen to you. I already know it makes you happy. It's just we got to find some way to, be catered to better, and buy me a new car and I'll be happier and then you'll be happier. Princess culture. And it's way worse than anyone knows. And of course the princesses are oblivious to it. They say, they don't need to listen to what's wrong. And, of course, if they hear something, they're absolutely shocked, stunned, like, what? They're so out of touch. They're so extraordinarily out of touch. Because they think it's that they already know what makes men happy, and there's no doubt about it. Of course, they're completely wrong about this. Completely wrong. Totally mistaken. And then, that they say, well, but I won't be righteous anymore. The corporations won't think I'm righteous. They will remove, and I will be guilty. I will be bad. I will be wrong. So they've been brainwashed by the corporations, so they're not willing to, take their, get rid of the guillotine. And so all these men are being guillotined. Really, well, they're so afraid of being guillotined that the fear kills them. And, the women cry crocodile tears, bury them, and say, well, at least I got the insurance policy, I got the house, got all this, and say, and the retirement, and say, okay, I can still be catered to, I can still remain righteous in the eyes of corporate culture, I can still remain righteous in the eyes of corporate culture. Okay, I'm okay. And of course, the men cannot even complain at all. If they complain, they say, "You're a war on women." You're a war on women. Of course, the women are terrified that there's something drastically wrong. But they say it's wrong. It's the men. They're not serving us wholeheartedly. They don't understand the righteousness of the situation. They don't understand how they can be, how to be saved. They're not catering to me properly, not allowing me to be catered to for the corporations properly. So the men are bad, the men are wrong, and then we fear a revolt, you know. So this war of women, they fear this revolt. So they're desperately trying to stamp that out. Horrible situation here, and we're looking for answers. Because the men are dying. They're dying, plain and simple. I mean, you talk to the young men now, you can see already, they're basically saying, I might as well not live at all. This is what they told me. I might as well not live at all. There's no hope. And you wonder why they abuse alcohol and drugs. And not just men, too. Women are under this, you know, pressure, too. But you look at the homeless, or look at the drug abuser, there's more men than women by a long shot. And, you know, someone just narrated this to me. This is the way they do business. They just hire homeless men, just pay them cigarette money, and then dump them on the street after they've done the job they wanted to do. They collect all the money, goes back to their wife to be catered to, and then they feel they're being a righteous man. You see? This is what's going on. They feel they're saved. I mean, women have convinced men that salvation is through pleasing women. That if women don't feel quite right, you know, it's the man's fault. Oh, I got to get more money, more catered, you know, more catered to him more. And this is corporate brainwashing from the ego. False antichrist religion that they're following. So of course women are terrified. I won't be catered to anymore. This is, you know, I'll turn into a vicious, you know. They're really afraid of their own viciousness. It's not, they project their own viciousness upon men, and it's just that the men are going to be completely vicious, a war against women. No, they won't. They just want to start breathing and start paying attention to the spiritual path. It's the viciousness that women are afraid of is their own viciousness projected onto men. Because if they stop being catered to, they're going to feel like there's no way they can ever be happy. And then they're going to go crazy with extreme anger. Keep in mind that in Dionysian cults, it was the women that everybody feared. In ancient times, pagan women were more feared than the men. They go crazy, they tear people to pieces. There's a saying, hell hath no fear like a woman scorned, meaning if the lack of catering to their, you know, creature comforts, not being catered to, they get absolutely furious. And King Solomon, they say he was the wisest of all people that ever been in the world. He says there's nothing that he feared nothing more ferocious or frightening than a woman not being catered to. It's the most frightening, terrifying, dangerous thing there is. This is King Solomon, paraphrasing. This is exactly what he said. So this has always been known. Hell hath no fury like a woman scorned, meaning they may not be catered to anymore as much as they're used to. So this whole war on women is just a complete egoic projection. What men want to do is they want to straighten out. Let me get on the right path here. You know, this isn't working for me. Let me find a path that works. I'm not interested in attacking women or something. That's ridiculous. I want to stay away from them as far as possible in most cases, you know. The slaves want to just get to freedom. Not really interested in attacking the plantation owners. It might be a few, but mostly, let me just get the heck out of here, you know, and get me far away from this as possible. And of course, the women are terrified that they won't be catered to, they won't be able to cater to their mortal existence, like, in enough, and they think that this is going to cause them to go insane. So they're projecting their fear of insanity, they're projecting their viciousness upon the men. This is what they're doing. Now, again, you must understand that my saying this is compassion for women. And I'm actually someone who does have compassion for women. Most men do not have any compassion at all. Because I experienced a time where women actually took their foot off the accelerator a little bit, you know, and I realized they can do this. And this is, I'm very appreciative of this. Extremely appreciative of this. Plus, I was helped by a woman guru, Sri Anandamayi Ma, for a while. Greatly helped, you see. So, this is, so just hear this, if you're a woman or a man thinking about a woman, is this has compassion, and I'm telling you what the straight situation is, so you don't get all, you don't get worse, you don't get worse. So we're not saying that women have to get rid of all their comforts and all this. But what you need to do is not make it a religion, okay, and realize it's a false religion. False religion. You can wear the same clothes. You don't have to always be in high fashion. You don't have to be all dolled up. You don't have to, be catered to in this way and that way and that way. You don't have to be this princess who's, you know, this evil princess, you know, trying to enslave men. You can back off a little bit and realize that the Holy Spirit, there's no favoritism in truth, the self. This whole lie about women being shut out of the self is just playing into the ego's narrative. Oh, well, we're mortal, so we have to be catered to mortally. This is an absolute lie. Or the idea, well, the female body is more really mortal than the male body because it gives birth to other mortal bodies. This is absolutely not true. All this whole dream of existence, all mortal bodies, this is all pretense, 100%. The female body's a pretense, 100%. The male body's a pretense, 100%. No difference whatsoever in terms of pretense. Zero. That means those who identify female bodies, male bodies, are exactly the same spirit. They're both 100% spirit, 100% pretense, and therefore they can 100% drop this pretense. Absolutely. But corporations have exploited women. Marketed to them. They're very clever about it. More clever than women realize. Because they're catered to, all sorts of vanity and comforts and pride and arrogance and projection. They say, hey, don't worry. They said, the women said, wait a minute, what happens? The men are not happy about this. And of course, corporations said, don't worry, just project. Project your own vicious fear about stopping this onto them. Problem solved, they say. Yeah, projection just solves your problem just like that. Make them feel guilty. They're the bad ones. They're out to attack you, not them. They're the crazy ones. And women, have said, well, that doesn't seem quite right, but I kind of like that new car. And then they say, well, just do it a little bit. You have to do it that much. But the problem is, you get into habits, and then habits get extremely difficult to break. This is what women overlooked. And you see, corporations always market to women's ego, their vanity, think like, oh, you can do it. You can multitask. You won't get trapped in habit. This is what, if you want to know the one key marketing factor that has fooled women, is to say, don't worry, you're better than men. You won't get trapped in habit. That's the difference. Men, they get trapped in habit. You see how single-minded they are. They say, well, that's habit. They're fixated. And whereas you can multitask. You won't get trapped in habit. And this is the Eve deception that the snake tells Eve. Say, you don't have to worry about getting trapped in habits. You can do this stuff. And anytime you want to, you can drop it. If it's too much for you, if you start getting a guilt complex, I don't want treatment like a slave. That's terrible. You can just, you can just stop. You're a woman. You can stop like that. You're multitasking. You don't worry about it at all. This is the big lie. This is the big lie. This is what underlies the situation in the world in terms of why it got so bad is because women, I know how it went. They said, hey, wait a minute, this isn't right, this isn't just. Yeah, but I really want that new house and a car and stuff. So, but this isn't, this is like treating men wrong. I don't want to be that way. And then the marketing was like, well, you can just do it for a little while. Try it out for a little while. And just like, look at it as a fashion thing. And they deserve some pushback anyway. So, just do a little bit. You don't have to do a lot. They said, but I can stop anytime I want. They said, of course. Of course you can. Don't worry about it. Oh, okay. Well, Yeah, I feel a little guilty about it actually, but okay, I'll get the car and then I'll say I'm sorry. You know, I'll make it up to him and you know, whatever. It's fine. Okay, I can stop whenever I want. And the ego says, sure you can, sure you can. Of course, the Holy Spirit was not saying that. The Holy Spirit was saying, no, don't go down that road, because you will build up all these bad habits, and then when you want to stop, you'll be stuck in these bad habits. And of course, the ego says to the woman, no, you don't suffer from that problem. You have some sort of like superior feminine capability. We'll just talk like multitasking or something, where you can like fashion. See, look how easy you can change from one fashion to the other. Well, habits are the same. No, they're not. Because the habit of being hooked on fashion, how about breaking that habit? See, that's the habit, so to speak. The idea is that, well, I can just change fashion. I'm not hooked on fashion because I'm changing one fashion for the other. See how I'm multitasking? I'm not hooked on this fashion. I don't have the habit. No, but you do have the habit of changing fashions. How about just dropping that habit? Oh, I can't do that. See, I'm stuck in that one. How about just wearing the same thing all the time? No. I got to be catered to. Oh, you're hooked on the habit of being catered to. So this is what has happened. Because I can tell you that women did not want to go down this road of radical feminism. Woman is always right. Let's change all the laws and turn men into slaves, which is what, you know, slaves. Let's not put a guillotine on our house. They did not want to go down that road. They were wiser back in the 60s than they are now. They said, hey, wait a minute. This smells like a rat. I don't trust it. They did not trust it. Remember, the radical feminists, there are only a few of them, and then they go, hey, sisters, come on, join. One said, whoa. This is too radical. This has got problems. I don't trust it. But then the corporate marketing came in, and gradually, through all the television programs, the magazines, the books, the movies, the parties that they have, you know, the shops, everything, the whole culture told them, hey, A little bit's not so bad. A little bit of drugs isn't so bad. You know, a little smoke cigarette, a little bit of smoking a cigarette's not so bad. A little bit of drinking's not so bad. A little bit of party's not. No, you know, don't be a square. They call it being a square. Don't be a square. You know, live a little bit. You know, there's nothing wrong with living a little bit. And gradually they built up these habits. And now these habits have become ferocious. And they're severe habits. And then women want to say, okay, I can back. Whoops, what is this? You know. The ego told me I wouldn't have this problem. Guess what? The ego lied to you. The ego lied to you. You have to accept this fact. Ego lied. This is exactly what happens. We decide, okay, I'm going to drop this. This is. I don't want to go down this road anymore. Oops. What's this terror that's arising within me? Oh my gosh, where did this come from? It feels like I'm stuck in these habits, but that's not possible because the ego told me I wouldn't get stuck in habits. I'm woman. I am, hear me roar. I am, you know, I'm always right. If I want to get free, I shouldn't have to have a problem with this. The ego told me I wouldn't have a problem. And then the ego says, well, yeah, well, you don't. It's the man. He's the one getting you stuck in these habits. He's the problem. Get a new man. Commit adultery, you know. Yes, he's the problem. He's the one sticking you in these habits. So the lies just keep going on and on and on. You see how it gets worse and worse and worse? Is you just keep projecting. As long as you believe that ego didn't lie to you, then you will then project it and say, no, okay, I don't have this problem, but the man is not catering to me properly. It's his fault, not my fault. And this doubling down on this. And I can bring I say all politics are spiritual politics, and now you can see. Let's be honest. Hillary Clinton is a radical, radical feminist, and she's the idea of doubling down on this corporate, you know, false corporate antichrist religion. Is the man is always wrong? It's his fault. It's his fault, and she's trying to sell this now to the public, saying here, this is the way forward. Is refuse to realize that the ego lied to us. And insist there's this massive war on women. Project our hostility, project our fear onto men, project our disaster. They're the fault, they're to blame, and we'll just tell them how to fix the problem by catering to us even more. Which is why many, many men have extremely dislike for Hillary Clinton. myself included, to be completely forthright. Absolutely. Disaster. It would be an absolute disaster if she was elected president. All politics are spiritual politics, and she represents the ego to the utmost. And she's a liar. She's an absolute bold-faced liar. Okay? And the fact that America is considering right now, in a poll, she would win the presidency, just shows how messed up, how egoically oriented this America is right now. But a lot of people don't want it. A lot of people don't want it. And hopefully this will grow and grow and grow. Again, so there's a point where women realize, wow, I'm stuck in my habits. I can't. What's wrong? I cannot back off of this. I don't really want to go any further. You know, this is a lot of people are at this stage right now. I don't really want to go any further. This enough is enough. Okay, so I feel this is going to somehow corrupt me in terms of I'm going to become a wicked person. I don't really want to do that. And they say, okay, I want to step back from that. And then the sudden dread arises within them. Okay, this is exactly what happens. And then they say, what the heck is this? And then the Holy Spirit will say, it's your habits. It's your habits. And it's your continuity fear around those habits. That's the problem. You need to break those habits. And you'll say, oh my gosh, how do I do that? And then the ego will say, no. Those aren't your habits. That's just the fact that you're getting pushback from the men. They want to be lazy. They don't want to keep, catering to you. They're lazy. They're rebellious slaves, you know. That's the problem. They're the ones. They're the bad ones. We got to crush them. And the women will say, wait a minute. I've already been doing that. I don't know if I want to double down. This seems to be a very, very bad way to go. But the ego is saying, double down on this. And the Holy Spirit says, no, it's my habits. I'm going to say, but wait a minute, ego. You told me that I wouldn't get stuck in my habits. You said I have some special ability as a woman. Multitasking, you know. And that there's men that are stuck in their habits. They're fixated. And Jesus points out to us, no, fixation is great because we are inherently fixated on God. All creation is inherently, completely fixated on God. Freud got this wrong. He thought fixations were bad. So a lot of Freudian psychology misled women, actually. You keep in mind that most of the those who were in therapy, the clients of the psychoanalysts that Freud gave rise to, his school psychoanalysis, were women. And they made a lot of advancements this way, but however, the problem that Freud had, he had certain problems like the issue of fixation. He thought fixation was bad and wrong, and you must avoid it. So ultimately, this ended up demonizing men because men tend to be much more, they focus on one goal, whereas women tend to multitask. So women thought that multitasking means they're avoiding fixation, or, you know, it's a misunderstanding of fixation. And they thought they were superior to men. And therefore, the ego could lie to them and says, you don't have to worry about habits. Your superiority will just annihilate these habits. What do you need to worry about? You know, you're superior. You know, don't be worried. Don't have the same worries. Men are worried about getting bad habits. They say, no, I've got to, you know, I can't drink. I can't do that. I've got to stay. I can't, you know, have any bad habits. But you as women, you don't need to worry about those bad habits. You know, you're superior. That's your superiority. Enjoy your superiority, the ego said. Enjoy your superiority. They have it worse. They're more fixated than you are. Of course, fixation, as Jesus tells us, is really the goal. We want to be perfectly fixated on reality. Okay? That is the goal. So Freud got it wrong. He had too much fear. You know, he made some progress, but ultimately it's ended up in this horrible radical feminism that we have now. And Hillary Clinton is an extreme radical feminist. She has been her entire life. And she feels that she's very much superior to men. She feels entitled to the presidency because of her superiority. She says, I don't have any bad habits. In fact, I don't do anything wrong. It's all the men that do stuff wrong. So this email thing is, what? What are you talking about? Me? I'm inherently incapable of doing anything wrong. So, you know, I don't have to worry about somebody else, some man, you know, let him commit suicide, you know. You know, if she drives a man to suicide, lets him be the fall guy, well, you know, that's his fault. You know, that's his role. who's that guy in the White House that committed suicide? They say that he was a fall guy, Foster something. Of course, get a fall guy. This is these radical feminists, they all have fall guys. Okay, who commit suicide for him, rather than say, hey, no, she did it. You know, it was her mistake. That's their goal. Ultimately, if you want to know what their goal is, they want the slaves to be fall guys. And if someone, you know, needs to have their head chopped off, they want the man to volunteer. Say, I'll do it for you, princess. And just say, well, of course you will. Of course you will. But I have a nice place in heaven for you. Don't worry. You know, just, you know, ISIS has a nice place in heaven for you. As long as you take the fall, so I don't have to admit that I'm stuck in bad habits. I don't have to admit I have a continuity fear. No, continuity fear, what are you talking about? If I wanted to get rid of it, I'd get rid of it just like that. But no, I enjoy this catering. I enjoy this. It's not that I have a continuity fear. It's just that I really enjoy this. You know, this is the big lie of the ego. So, like I have said, I am Trump on steroids. Or not, you know, I'm Trump times 1,000. He can't say this stuff, okay? He's saying some stuff, you know. He's just kind of like, you know, throwing his elbows around a little bit, saying, well, you know, I don't really like to, but I'm like Trump times 1,000 or 100,000, actually, because I actually tell it like this. He's straightforward, and he's telling it as far as he sees it. And there's something interesting about him. He was sent to military boarding school when he was young and spent 5 years away from his family, totally in this military boarding school, which was super strict discipline, where you had to be, you could not lie, steal, or cheat, and you had to be honest and straightforward about everything. Everyone had to be honest and straightforward to one another. This was the culture of this military boarding school. So this is why he's so straightforward and just a straight shooter. He tells it like he sees it. You know, he's not some, you know, crazy, oh, how dare you see. That's just him. That's how he was raised as a child. This is military discipline. You know, military is honest. You know, they're trying to be honest, straightforward. Don't lie, steal, cheat. This is the called military culture. Military culture is really one of the best cultures there is in terms of, you know, the honorable culture. That, you know, you're straightforward with people. No beating around the bush. Did you do it or did you not do it? And this is how I was raised too. I was raised, my dad being World War II veteran, he got this drilled into him that, you know, you're just honest. You never lie, steal, or cheat. And you're straightforward, and that's all there is to it, and there's no other way than that, period. And that's how I was raised. So, you know, you don't think, you're just, that's it. There's not another way. And Trump is like this. Trump is like this. He just, you know, this is the way he is. He tells it as he sees it. Tells it as he sees it. And a lot of the times he's accurate. But the radical feminists are absolutely freaked out about this, you know. Just, but the slaves, you know, they might, you know, they might want to be the fall guys for me. You know, I mean, Hillary Clinton is just, you know, is so out of touch. And you know, she says, look, what, I don't have to worry about. Are you kidding me? I'm the queen. Yeah, I write the rules. You don't tell me what rules to follow. I write the rules. And if I want to do it this way, I'll do it this way. If I want to do it the other way, I'll do it the other way. To heck with rules. Rules don't apply to me. The rules have never applied to the Clintons. So, you know, you think, well, that you're being political. So, no, I'm being real and pragmatic. I said, all politics is spiritual politics, and I have shown you why this is so. It is very, very true. And some people might not like it. Well, too bad. It's still true. It's still true. You cannot rely on magic to save you. Okay, magic doesn't work. Being loyal to the ego doesn't work. Because what does the ego tell you? Say, he'll always tell you, you don't have a continuity fear. You don't have bad habits. You're not stuck in habits and continuity fear. That in any time, you can just drop those like that. Just double down, double down, double down. And it's someone else's fault. All the upset you're feeling, project, 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 project. And I've tied it into psychoanalysis and Freud and Jesus, and of course, the miracles points this out. He says, well, Freud did a lot of good work. I'm not going to deny that. But his mind was still stuck in a lot of fear, and he twisted things backwards in a lot of ways. And then Jesus highlights the projection, how we use that and all this stuff. He's pointing out this culture's screwed up. That's what he's saying. It is really screwed up. and he's helping, you know, helping us get free from it. That is for sure. So a lot of people, women and men included, you know, a lot of women are supporting Trump too, believe it or not. The narrative from the radical feminists is no woman could possibly support Trump. If she does, she's a slave of a man. You know, this is their crazy upside down backward projection of their own desire to enslave men. You know, they project that, and they say, no, men want to enslave women, and any woman who doesn't support us, she's just a slave, which is utter nonsense. Utter nonsense. Women always have massive power and leverage in this world. And you know, it's women saying, hey, wait a minute, I don't want to double down. I feel I do have bad habits. I do feel I do have a continuity problem. I feel I do want eternal life. I think it's extremely bad to enslave men and put them under the sphere of the guillotine, because they're unable then to focus spiritually themselves. They're unable to focus spiritually themselves. And so there's no straightforwardness at all. And my habits get worse. My continuity fear gets worse. This is terrible. I don't want to double down. So really, the liberal, progressive, radical, corporate feminists are extremely sexist towards women. Extraordinarily sexist towards them. Because they're saying, if you don't agree with us, then you're just a little idiot slave and you can't think for yourself. We know what's best for you. They're extraordinarily demeaning and sexist towards women. It's women that are sexist to women, actually. The radical feminists are extraordinary. They're saying that you can't possibly really think for yourself and know better for yourself. That's impossible. You must be brainwashed by men if you think that way. That's what they're thinking. Because no, they want to brainwash all women to their egoic false point of view. So there's a lot of women who are saying, hey, I can think for myself. My husband is not controlling me. The fact that we may think alike doesn't mean I'm enslaved. I can recognize I have bad habits. How demeaning is it? What an utter sexist put down to think that I can't be aware of the fact that I have bad habits, that I have a continuity problem, that men can help me with this, that women can help me, I can help myself, men can help me. How utterly sexist and demeaning to try and put that down, you know? And this is what the radical feminist, Clintonites, liberal progressives, which are corporate propagandists, this is egoic. Humanist, secular humanist, this is what they're saying. They're the sexists. They're the ones who are sexist. There's the ones that are racist. There's the ones that are bigoted, etc., etc., etc. And they just project that on those who are not. Fundamentally not. They project it. They project that on those who have common sense. So it's a spiritual situation right now in the world. Very much spiritual situation. This election cycle, which is, Holy Spirit is very aware of it. And it said, you know, starting June 22nd, all hell's going to break loose. And it has. It has. Which is a good thing. The apocalypse is a great thing. Because we can really, you know, and now let's say you're a woman or a man, but use a woman for example, and you realize, hey, you know, I really do have, the ego lied to me. I really did go down the wrong road. I really have a lot of bad habits. I have, and I'm used to being catered to. I'm used to putting the man down and thinking, and oh my gosh, the laws have put a man in a straitjacket. They can't push back in any way towards me. I can completely abuse them. They can do nothing. This is terrible for me. They can't breathe. They're suffering. They're going to die. They're going to lose their income. It's a lose, lose, lose. I don't like it. But they think, oh my gosh, but you know, God's going to not like me. No, just the opposite. Now, there's nothing that the Holy Spirit loves more than those who admit, hey, I have a problem. I have a continuity problem. You say, hey, Holy Spirit, I see I have a severe continuity problem. And the Holy Spirit will say, fantastic. Don't worry. You're on the road to salvation. I'll see you all the way through to the very end. And that's what happened with me. It's exactly what happened. I didn't see it as clearly then, but in hindsight, this is what happened. It's the women that inculcate their habits in their children and the habits in society. And trying to go against that is very difficult, but the Holy Spirit's capable of doing it, believe it or not. And it's and therefore it is capable also of taking women, those who identify as this mortal woman, so to speak, which is all pretense, of course. Holy Spirit can take them back all the way to realizing, I'm not a body, I'm free, I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. I'm spirit. You see, this I was just pretending to be more mortal. It was completely untrue. And, you know, I'm giving out these teachings to everybody. I'm not saying, well, you know, women can't have these teachings. No, only men can have these teachings. And no, this has been given out equally to everybody. That should tell you right there what the Holy Spirit's like. Now, pragmatically, there could be some pragmatic issues. I'm not going to let, you know, women, you know, feminist women tell me what to do. You know, and they're, of course, they're going to project and say, well, you're evil if you don't, etc. And you can't trust this guy because he doesn't let us, he's not allowing us to be in charge and all this. So there's this intense projection going on, and most people can't see through this. So they might say, well, you're a terrible person. You're sexist, blah, 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 blah. I know that's not true. I'm pragmatic. Holy Spirit's pragmatic. I understand how women absolutely can seize control. They seize control of the universities. Absolutely they have. Whatever they get into, they seize control over. This is blatantly obvious. So many, 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 many professions and situations now where women are entirely in control. They're in control of the White House right now, actually. They're in control of the legal system. They're in control of corporations. They're in control of universities, I said. You know, you name it, you know. Once they get into it, the tendency is to they want to be catered to. They say, we want to feel as though we're being catered to. If you're not, you're making me feel uncomfortable. And this is legally wrong. You're sexist. You're discriminating. Yeah, discrimination lawsuits. Twitter's getting discrimination lawsuits. This whole legal system is designed to file discrimination lawsuits and intimidate corporations, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And then once women get the foot in the door, they say, I don't feel I'm being catered to enough. And it's never enough. So you can't win. You can't win. And men have been saying this throughout history. You just, with women, you can never win. You can never win. It's never enough. It's never enough. But this is really the egoic religion, which is never enough. Because we can never feel satisfied enough with the belief in mortal existence, no matter how much we're catered to. You take the greatest queen, the greatest king, and all the catering that they had. Were they ever satisfied? No. They wanted more. They wanted a greater kingdom, a greater empire. The king would conquer, and come back and bring all this gold treasure, and the queen would say, oh, it's wonderful, I'm being so catered to. A little while later, she's saying, you know, I'm just not really entirely satisfied. I want more. Go conquer more for me. Yeah, they'd marry a great warrior. They'd look for who's the greatest warrior. You know, the women that want to be catered to, they look for the warriors. And then they marry them. And they say, wow, they don't know how to seduce them. They marry them. They say, okay, your job is to, you know, get more for me. Go out and conquer. And the warrior thinking that, you know, the way that he can be righteous is to for the woman to say he's righteous. The whole idea that women somehow stand in the way of eternal life for us, and they have to okay us. It's like, you know, it's like they say, well, if I don't say you're okay, you can't have eternal life. You know, this is the goddess religion, which is just so terrible. It's an egoic religion. The notion that somehow, you know, that a man can't have eternal life unless the woman says that okay. You know, the intercessor, you know, Mary stands in the way. Mary goes to Jesus, says, of course. The guy says, hey, Jesus, I want to drop this pretension of mortality and have eternal life. And Jesus says, of course you can. You know, you've never been mortal life. You've always been eternal life. So there's no option. Of course you have to. And then the woman says, hey, wait. You know, hey, psst, 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 psst. Hey, Mary, you know, I don't really want this guy, you know, realizing he's eternal life because, you know, he won't be catering to me as much, and I don't want that. And I might go crazy. I might go, you know, I might get vicious. I might realize my own bad habits and continuity fear, and I don't want that. That's too much work for me. Hey, Mary, can you go intercede with Jesus? Can you go talk to Jesus for me? And of course, the goddess will say, the ego goddess would, you know, will say, of course I can. Don't worry, my dear. don't worry, my dear. I see the tears you're crying because you're not going to be catered to so much anymore. This is horrible. I feel your pain. I feel your sorrow. I'm a woman. I can understand. We like to be catered to. You know, we don't like to be faced that we have bad habits and continuity problems. That's not right. We have to give birth and raise children. That's so difficult. So we should be excused from this continuity problem thingy, you know, whatever it is. So, of course, I will go talk to Jesus. Don't worry. I can change his mind. I know how to change his mind, you know. I can tell, hey, Jesus, you're not catering to me enough. And Jesus will say, whoops. Hey, Jesus, you're kind of sexist here. You know, you're the women, you're bothering them, and you're kind of sexist, aren't you? Oh, Jesus, what's he going to say? Oh, God, you're right. I'm sorry. Okay, and what can I do, you know? What can I do? They don't talk about the case specifically at first. They just, you know, Mary will say, Jesus, you know, you're great, you're wonderful, but these women here, they're complaining to me, they're saying the men just aren't really catering to them enough, and, you know, you're saying they're going to have eternal life, even though they're not really deserving, and it's not really fair, you know, and, you know, kind of this, you know, maybe you're like, you know, a little bit leaning too much, favoring men, you're a little bit sexist, and then, you know, they're thinking that Jesus will say, oh my gosh, I didn't really realize that. Maybe I have some bad habit like that. I didn't see it. I had a blind spot. Thanks for pointing it out. And what can I do? How can I make this right? She goes, here's an example. Actually, there's a few ways you can do this. This guy that you said you could have eternal life, just ease off on that. Say you almost can have eternal life, but, you know, there's a few things you need to do first. If you could just treat your wife a little better, and, you know, she likes these things. She kind of likes the lifestyle. You could just make a little more money, listen to what she says, respond to what she says, and realize that really, you know, you really can't really have eternal life unless I also check off on that. You got to go through both of us, Jesus, not just you, but me too, okay? Because I represent the woman side of the situation. And then we think like Jesus says, oh my gosh, yeah, I see that you're right, Goddess Mary, you know, I see that you're right about that. I was wrong. I didn't realize that, you know, that actually, you know, that this dynamic, I missed that one, huh? Yeah, okay, that, yeah, women really don't have problems with the continuity fear and habits and need to break those and need to work on it. It's that doesn't work that way, huh? And really, not everyone really has eternal life directly, that they only have it if you say they have it and I say they have it. It's not God that gave it to them, but we're somehow have the right to stand in their way. Is that how it works? She goes, yeah, that's how it works. Oh. So most people believe in that Jesus. You know, let me tell you, that Jesus doesn't exist. Doesn't exist at all. Doesn't exist at all. But most people who, you know, believe in Jesus believe that there's this, you know, you don't get it. Jesus really can't himself give it to you. Mary has to also agree. And of course, she's taken the woman's side, which is the ego side of lying to the woman, saying, you can change your habits and continuity thing, just like that. And if you can't, it's the man's fault. Which means women never get down to do the tough work of the spiritual path. Because as soon as they start doing it, they say, wow, this is really difficult. And the ego say, well, you don't have to do that. What are you doing that for? You don't have to do that. That's man's job, not yours. Yeah. You know, it's man's problem. If you feel you have a problem with habits and continuity, that's the man's fault. He's lying to you. He's deceiving you. He's trying to enslave you. No, you should just be able to do it like that. That's a woman's prerogative. And so the women, you know, say, oh, really? Wow, that makes it a lot easier, doesn't it? Of course it doesn't, because it's a lie. And women then don't focus on the spiritual path like they're supposed to. They don't get the job done. Then they blame the men, and things go to hell. And you end up with religion, goddess religion. They keep Jesus around, of course, but they just added something to it. They say, yeah, we both have to agree. Not just Jesus, not just the Holy Spirit, not just God, but Mary too. I mean, even if God says, sure, you can have eternal life, Mary will say, no, wait, I've got to check off on this too. What that really is saying both Jesus and the ego need to agree on anything concerning with religion. both Jesus and the ego, both the Holy Spirit and the ego need to agree. And if the ego says, sure, you can have eternal life right now. In fact, you are eternal life right now. But the ego says, no, not yet, not yet. You're still causing habit problems, continuity problems for your wife or for these women. That's not right. So you're not done yet. Your work is not done. This is religion. This is the ego's religion saying, yeah, the ego saying, well, of course I'm allowing Holy Spirit to have its say, but I got the right to have my say too. So we both have our say, and if we both agree, good. But if we disagree, no, then you know you cannot have eternal life. You have still work to do. And most people are following this false religion. This false religion. Which is why they're getting nowhere. In fact, things are getting worse. Now, if we talk more about politics, our language might become a lot, you know, tougher and personal. I don't want to get too much into that. I've just personalized it just for the importance of the one issue of who's going to control the narrative, who's going to be, you know, the most powerful person in the world, which is the President of the United States is the most powerful person in the world in a lot of ways, which is, you know, puppet of corporate humanism. So that's extremely important. So if somebody is claiming that they have a right to be that, entitled to that, and they're going to win it, you know. Well, then, you know, we have a right to take a close look at that. But, you know, if you get too much into politics, then it gets real nasty because you talk about the corporate shills at work, and there's so many, you know, so many women, radical feminists, are pretending to be compromising, but they're really not. They're pretending to be fair. They're really not. You know, it gets very nasty. And we don't want to get bogged down in that. Trump is doing that. He tends to, you know, any battle is a good battle. He's a warrior. And so if somebody irritates him, he jumps into the battle instead of, you know, saying, wait a minute, maybe I want to choose my battles here. Let me not, you know, he has a problem with that. And that's getting exploited. You know, it's like they're sticking the elephant with spears, and the elephant turns around. Hey, you know, someone else sticks. Hey, I mean, don't do that. Whereas the real big elephants, they don't even react at all. So somebody's trying to poke me. So what? I got bigger fish to fry. But serving a purpose. I mean, it's going to be tough for him for sure. Death by a thousand cuts. But he's pointing out, hey, you're just a radical. You're just a fake, you know, you're just a corporate shill pretending to be even-handed and equitable. You're not at all. You're not at all. You're actually, you know, you're actually a radical feminist corporate humanist and not fair and balanced at all. He's pointing it out. It's coming out now. It's coming out that even those pretending to be on the side of righteousness are actually part of the corporate. You know, corporations try to have both sides paid off. And this is what Trump has said. He says, both the Democrats and the Republicans are completely corrupt. And he's absolutely right about that. They're all paid off by corporations. They're all corporate shills. This is true. And he says, I know, because I paid them both off. I was there. I paid both sides. He's honest. He said, look, they asked him, did you pay? So I said, yeah, I gave him $2,000. I mean, what politician is honest as this? Nobody's this honest. I mean, he said, yeah. I came to my office. He's begging for money, want $2,000. I said, okay. You know, I want to do business in New York. I need your vote. Fine. This is the game. This is how it works. So, yeah, he just admits to it. He's honest. Yeah, we're all stunned by it. So what is this? Was it some kind of trick, some kind of trap? What are these? I'm honest. Straightforward. I've never heard a politician be honest and straightforward. Well, he's not a politician. He's a business person. And so he knows the inside corruption of the whole political system because he was the one benefiting from this. But he is a business person. He says, you have to do it to do business. There's no other choice. If you want to succeed, this is the game. But he says, I don't like it. I want to reform it. I want to change it. I'm willing to pay more taxes. You know, it's not good. He says it's not good for the middle class. And he's right. It's not good for the middle class. It's terrible. But I know I was part of it. So, you know, it's like, wow, the establishment is just furious about this. You can't spill the beans like this. But the people are realizing, hey, someone's finally telling us the truth. This is the bottom line. You know, the media thinks that they can cause everybody to turn on them. No, they can't. Because we say, hey, it doesn't matter what, you know, personal peccadilloes and things, whatever. The fact is, somebody's telling us the truth about political system, you know, the corporate political system, how, you know, just like JFK, I mean, Eisenhower told us the truth about the military-industrial complex, and we appreciated that. He was straightforward about it. He said, look, you've got a severe problem, America. It's way worse than you know. And I'm an insider about it. Eisenhower knew about the extraterrestrials, by the way. Okay, I've told you about this. Well, speaking of extraterrestrials, Edgar Mitchell, one of the first people to walk on the moon, one of the only people to walk on the moon, really, very much an insider in terms of the high power structure of this world. He came out recently and confessed and told us, look, I know I was told this by very, very higher people, higher ups who would absolutely be in the know, like the commander of, you know, missile testing told me this. The number one guy. He says a lot of our missile tests and our testing was shot down by extraterrestrials. Extraterrestrials appeared here in large numbers when we started doing atomic testing, atomic bomb and atomic testing, and they were worried we were going to get into a nuclear war, and they made sure we didn't, actually. And the higher-ups know this, for sure, and Edgar Mitchell knows this, and he was told these things by the higher-ups, and now he's getting old, he realizes what this is the apocalypse, and now he has spilled the beans, and most people didn't even pay attention to it. I sure did. What he's saying is astonishing. I mean, we know it, but to confirm it, you know, it's very important. Extraterrestrials have been here. Eisenhower knew they were here. He got information from Area 51 in Nevada. He said, if you don't tell me what's going on, I'm going to send this whole division in, and I'm going to completely take you over, period. And I'm going to force you into giving me answers. And they gave him the answers. They told him what, they didn't tell him everything. They told him what he thought would be enough for him. But they told him enough where he was shocked and stunned by it. And that's why he said, hey, when he was leaving office, he said, you've got this terrible problem, America. He said, military, he didn't say aliens. They told him not to. You have this military industrial complex, which is way more problematic than you realize. Ronald Reagan spilled the beans saying the real problem is the threat from space aliens. You know, people thought he was crazy, although he was a lunatic, Reagan. No, he knew. JFK knew about it, was probably going to spill the beans on it. That's probably why he was assassinated, actually. Now, Trump was asked this question about JFK. They were trying to trip him up. He was smart enough to say, I think Oswald acted alone. He didn't want to get into it, which is fine. But those who know about it realize that JFK, there were those who decided they had to get him out of the way because he was going to spill the beans on what's going on. Extraterrestrial presence in not in many ways, but one of the ways was to prevent, you know, nuclear war. But they're doing all sorts of stuff and working through the corporations. Now, why do they want to stop nuclear war? Well, they said, well, that would affect our dimension. It's caused problems. Well, maybe. But the thing is, they want to take over this world. Imagine if you want this resort. Look at this resort. Oh, it's a really nice resort. You know, I want to own that resort, like Pebble Beach. Just, you know, I want to buy that resort. I want to own it. And let's say the owners own it right now. Have all these policies that are like, they said, burn, cut down this forest, burn this, you know, pollute the lake here, do all this stuff. You'd be furious, wouldn't you? Say, wait a minute, I'm going to buy this resort soon. I'm going to take it over. I don't want it to be all messed up. I want it to be pristine and really nice so I can enjoy the resort. So the extraterrestrials, and we think, oh, they're on our side. No, they're on their side. They are taking over this planet. They've already done so, basically. They want this to be their resort, and they want it to be nice. So of course that they want, you know, they want to be in control of the policy here in this world so that their resort is nice, and they think we're screwing it up for them. This is self-interest on their part. Self-interest. They don't really have our best interest at heart at all, the extraterrestrials. They don't even know what it is. They don't even know anything about salvation, actually. Eternal life. They don't understand it. They just understand how to cater to the ego, cater to mortality, and they think, oh, this world would be a really nice way to cater to our mortality. Let's take it over. And so they have. And they came in here like the white knight saying, you know, we know how to save the world. Let's put women in charge of management and they won't mess it up so bad and we'll control the whole narrative from behind the scenes and they can be the front people for us and all this kind of things. And they know, they have the blueprints, they know how to do it. And they've been successful at it. But it's out of self-interest, 100%. 100%. They say, we're taking over, we want this world to be nice because we're going to own it. We want this asset to be a good asset. We want this asset to cater to us. This asset's for the purpose of super, super catering to every whim. And so we want it to be able to do so. We don't want a nuclear war here. Of course, we don't want it either. Because we want the world to cater to our whims too. So we felt like it's a win-win. But it's turning out now to be kind of a lose-lose, isn't it? Yeah, it's turning out to be very nasty indeed. Because, you know, that's not the way. That's a false religion. That's the Antichrist religion. Extraterrestrials do not know. They're just more sophisticated, catering to mortality. So we think, oh, wow, yeah, this is great, you know. Especially the women like ETs, you know. A lot of them are in contact, psychic contact with ETs and listening. And actually, they're in this symbiotic relationship where they're actually just carrying out the plans that the ETs are, you know, the blueprint. A lot of them have this sort of dualistic personality that they're actually being controlled by extraterrestrials psychically, like psychic implants, so to speak. A lot of them, millions and millions and millions and millions of them reported being taken aboard these extraterrestrial crafts and having implants and having various things done to them to make them simpatico with the extraterrestrial agenda, etc. Millions, millions honestly reported that. See, back in the 70s, 80s, women were way more honest than they are now. Now they're very dishonest. Back then, they were way more honest. Way more honest. And they reported. They said, hey, they go to the male psychiatrist and say, look, I was abducted. I was taken aboard. They explained the detail. Of course, we said, huh. Psychiatrist said, huh, it sounds like an Oedipus complex to me, you know. Some sort of weird transference here. I don't quite have my finger on it, you know. But gradually, the therapist started saying, hey, wait a minute, maybe this is really happening. So women used to report, you know, honestly to men, say, this is what happened. What do you think? What do you think's happening? And the men figured it out. They said, I think you are being abducted. I think there's something going on. I think the extraterrestrials are taking over. But these days, the women finally decide, whoa, let's double down on deceit. You know, we don't got to bury this. You know, let's bury the story. Bury it. So they've absolutely buried it. And now they're very, very deceitful. And they're in fact, the main constituency that are trying to elect Hillary Clinton, who's an extraordinary liar. She's just, her fundamental nature is to be a liar. She's a liar, plain and simple. And extremely dishonest, as is her husband. And we could say a lot of other things about this. That's very, very, very strong. And they're the ones who are electing. And they say, we need to double down. Let's bury this story. You know, we don't want anyone realizing what's really going on. And the extraterrestrials are telling them this. We don't want people to know what's going on. We're actually taking over. We've actually taken over. You know, we want to consolidate. Now we want to consolidate our power here. You know, they don't want anybody realizing that or thinking this way, the story. They want to bury the story. And they've done so. They've done so. It's amazing what we've forgotten. That was what going on in the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, even the 90s. You know, once the internet got up and rolling, a lot of the stuff just got buried. I mean, the women were very, much more honest, you would say. Much more honest. You can say that they were honest. You know, there was some evasion, of course, but they did spill the beans. They said, this is my experiencing. Can you help me understand what's going on? Of course, most of the men were therapists for men, you know. And they would talk to the men. They'd say, yeah, this is freaking me out. What's going on? Nowadays, they won't even do that at all. The men don't know anything. We're just idiots, of course, because that's burying the story. Because the men will say, wait a minute, I remember when you told me that you were, you know, being involved with extraterrestrials, having sexual relations with extraterrestrials and all that stuff. I remember when you told me about that. Oh, no, you're crazy. You know, you're crazy. I never said anything like that. You don't know what you're talking about, right? So men are idiots, you know. They want to bury the story. So this is a lot of information, and just say, okay, just maybe this is true, maybe it isn't. And you say, yes, I know this exact, I know that all this is just spot on, and all this is not spot on. Do this practice if you want to. You can do the assertion practice. You can do any one of the four phase practices. Do the best you can. You can assert, yes, I know this is absolutely true. You can just make assertion. Yes, I know that I can turn to the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit knows how to free me from my continuity problem. In fact, I am going to be free of my continuity problem. I absolutely know that I am going to be free of my continuity problem. You know, I actually have the capacity. You know, you can do assertions about this, or in the fourth phase, you can say, everything that is said here is absolutely true, and everything that is said here is absolutely not true. In other words, don't get fixated on a concept of any of this. And then therefore you can just allow what's being said to spiritually awaken you instead of get fixated on a concept. And I think this may have stopped. Is it still going? It is still going. Okay. So if you're really advanced, you can do this. You know, yes, this is true and this is not true. Yes, I hear this and I don't hear this. I absolutely have been helped by this and I absolutely have not been helped by this. So I recommend, you know, if those of you who do fourth phase practice, absolutely do this practice. It'll be the best practice of all. Because then whatever the truth of the situation will resonate, and automatically you'll start awakening without being fixated conceptually in any way. This is the best practice, is no conceptual fixation. So I know this is absolutely true, and I know this is absolutely not true. Yes, I absolutely understand this, and I absolutely do not understand this. I both understand this and do not understand this. I both agree with this and do not agree with this. I both accept this and do not accept this. I heard what was said and did not hear what was said. This was both very helpful and not very helpful. So if you can practice this way, I highly suggest you practice this way. And this will actually help you more than anything, because you won't get conceptually fixated in any way. You'll still feel free. You won't feel burdened by this. You won't feel fixated. And just the resonance of it will just, you just get used to it. Full stop in the wow. This is about ready to finish up now.